14th March 2020. I guess all of you remember this day because it was when the Spanish government shut down our normal life and we have a lockdown because there was a virus that was spreading worldwide. Yeah, you guess it. This one is the one to blame. So, I don't know if we have learned something about this situation, but we need a fast and reliable diagnostics tool that allow us to avoid bottlenecks in future critical situations that for sure we are going to face. We were suffering a lot when we didn't have enough reagents to run as many PCRs as possible. So we will stay at home waiting for the results. And in the meantime, our health system was collapsing. At that time, there was this rapid diagnostic test that were developed, and you will be able to know if you were having the COVID virus within minutes just at your home. Luckily, almost 2 years later, we are here because there was a quick and very grateful development in the vaccines. So we are able again to face each other. And we have now to see that maybe we have to control the immunity response within the population because we don't want to see any new collapses. And this is the motivation of this work. Today, I'm going to tell you how magnetic nanolabels can help us in developing a serological test for COVID virus. I would like to thank first the organizers for giving me this opportunity, but also the IEEE Magnetic Society, because this project has been funded by the SIG funding program for students, and it's been given in the University of Oviedo. So first, let me explain you a little bit how the immune response of our body works. So when we get infected here, the virus starts to replicate within our cells, and the RNA increases in concentration. It's then when the body recognizes there is an stranger and it starts producing what we call the soldiers of our immune system, that are the antibodies. There are a lot of different ones that you can see here, but let's focus on two. The first one is the IgM, which is the first one in be present in our immune response, and it's usually considered as a biomarker of the infection. However, IgG, it appears later, but it lasts longer. So we can use this as a biomarker of how is going the evolution of the immune response. So we are going to work with immunoassays, which are the same technology as the home brain assay test. So let's make them just a piece of paper in which we are going to print two different lines. In the first line, in this case, we're going to print the spike protein of the SARS-CoV-2, and we are going to print as well a control line. So if the sample has IgGs, it will get trapped here in the test line and also in the control line. But if we want to know there is something there in the test line, we have to label this antibody. And to do that, we are going to use magnetic nanoparticles. So if there is IgG present in the sample, these magnetic nanoparticles will get stuck in the test line, and it will be a positive test. So these two lines will appear in the test and the control line. Otherwise, if there is no IgG in the sample, here we will only see the control line, meaning that the test has been run successfully. Then, how are we going to see this test line? We are going to use magnetic nanolabels, but in this case have been synthesized by a solvothermal polyol process. And you can see here that they are quite similar to the one that Mariona presented yesterday. So they are clusters of about 100 nanometers, and they are composed of magnetic nanoparticles of around 7 nanometers. All of these particles in the clusters are gathered together by a polyacrylic acid network. So we have done the magnetic characterization of these nanoparticles, and here you have the room temperature magnetization curve, in which you can see that almost there is any remanence and coercivity. So we suppose that the magnetic nanoparticles are within the superparamagnetic regime. However, when we perform the setup CFC curve, we see that all of them seem to be blocked. Also, if we do the distribution of the blocking temperatures, which is obtained by doing the derivative of the subtraction of the field cooling minus the acetylene cooling course. We can see that it has different bands here, so it seems that there are a lot of different critical sizes in our samples. Also, when we perform the fitting, the Langevin fitting to get the magnetic diameter, we observe that the diameter is almost double the diameter that we got from 10 images, which was 7 nanometers, and now here the magnetic one is almost 15. So all of this may indicate that our clusters have a lot of interaction within them, but what is interesting for our application is that they have a really good initial magnetic permeability, so we are glad to use them. But then we have to conjugate them to something that can recognize our ETG in our sample. So we are going to take advantage of the carboxylic groups at the surface, and then we are going to use a chemistry to attach a bioaccumulated antibody that is able to recognize this immune response in the samples. So now our nanolabel is already is ready to be used in our test. And here you have the results. Here at the top, you can see a strip without any antibodies in the sample. And here the second one is a strip that has antibodies in the sample. So you can see how the negative and the positive, there is a considerable increase in the intensity of the test line, meaning that we are detecting something. So I would like you to remember this graph from the previous slide. And as I told you, the IgG, even if it was the one that appears a little bit later, usually reaches a maximum at 17 micrograms per milliliter, but this positive test has a concentration of about 5 micrograms per milliliter. So in this case, we are having notification that we are around this zone, which is a really good zone to monitor the evolution of the immune response in the population. So these were very interesting results. And to conclude, we had to learn the tough way that we need fast and affordable diagnostic steps and combining immunoassays and magnetic nanoparticles. All of them can accomplish these two characteristics. So we have proved this because we have developed a rapid test that is able to detect in the clinical range the immune response to COVID-19 too. And it was very interesting results, but we look forward to optimize the bioconjugation process, also the characteristics of the nanoparticles because we have a lot to do there, and also the magnetic sensor. But also we want to open the door to also detect and quantify the IgM to combine both diagnostic and also monitoring of the immune response. Thank you.